I'll be going over the definition of VR, the present status of it, and some misconceptions on it that people still have, and then some developer perspectives on it. And then if I have some time, some of my personal prototypes. I'm currently a student at Tampere University. I do prototypes and study mixed reality concepts because it's awesome. And I don't have a game, I don't have a company. And this is just an umbrella term for my work. Much of this talk is subjective and my personal opinion, but VR is really too new to have any real authority figures. And it's not even probably here yet. So what is VR exactly? It's an old idea, but it's still not widely understood completely. And the developers are not innocent in this. And they are, in fact, in danger of doing harm to the form of media. And wrong expectations that conflict with reality can lead to disappointment, confusion, and premature dismissal of an entire art form. VR is often confused with other parts of the mixed reality spectrum, so it's probably easier to start there. This is reality. This is where most of us live. This is where we eat. This is where we sleep. This is where we play our Xbox. It looks and feels like reality because it is reality. This is not VR. Then we have augmented reality. And this is virtual stuff in the real environment. AR tracks and matches reality. And it's an extremely promising field for the near future. And I could talk for hours on augmented reality alone. But this is not VR. Then we have augmented virtuality. And this is essentially a mirror image of augmented reality. It's real stuff in a virtual environment. And whenever people talk about virtual reality, they mention the holodeck. Close, but they are still real people. And we have pilot training simulators and projected cave environments that also have real people in them. For practical purposes, in many cases, these are enough for their purpose, but it is not VR. And then we have VR. This is the Matrix. This is a complete replacement of our experience with the virtual world. It looks and feels like reality because our senses tell us it is reality. It also does not need to look and or function like reality. It just needs to convince our senses that it is. And we get really, really excited with this vision. We start to dream all the ways it will make everything awesome. VR will become the primary way of life. Traditional forms of media will die. VR will magically make everything better. But even people who understand the basic definition of the medium can be confused with what this means for the end product. There's a lot of unsupported hype. The decades of philosophy has been unchecked by reality because VR has not existed to be checked against. These are the people who expected flying cars and jetpacks. And then there's the crowd who thinks it's a gimmick. We have all seen this before with 3D TVs, Kinect, Wiimotes, all those things. It's kind of cool, but more or less a useless gimmick. More useful as marketing material than real gaming devices. We have seen the hype and have been disappointed. How is a 3D monitor on your face any different? To get some perspective between these two extremes, we go deeper and see what we are trying to do, how it works, and how it's different from traditional media. Our experience of reality is based on a mental model. We use our senses to analyze reality and form understanding of how reality works. And then we interact based on that model. Our experience of traditional media in reality happens through abstractions. When we play a traditional video game, We sense the reality, devices in that reality that works as proxy to see and interact with the game. We have to include that interaction abstraction relationship in our mental model. Our perception is split in two worlds. We can play a game and be immersed in it, but it relies on the learned abstraction context of the machine, much like we learn to ride a bike or drive a car. But we never feel like we are the car. And this is the defining limitation with the premise of traditional media. It is designed to control a machine. The abstract act of pressing a button to play a jump animation will never equal the experience of performing a jump. Adding more complexity for more actions just pushes us even further away from a real experience. Muscle memory helps, but only up to a point. Looking at the problem from this perspective, VR is a gimmick. It is seen as an interface for the computer. Unfortunately, many VR developers still have this view. They see VR as an extension an add-on to improve traditional media. But incremental improvement on abstraction does not matter, because the premise is flawed. This is why other gimmicks have failed. The mental model is the problem. The idea of VR is not to interface with a machine, but to interface and recreate the full range of our physical sensory system without you noticing. The goal is to completely cut out the conscious abstractions between the user and the simulation, to bypass physical reality and directly interact with simulation without any conscious proxies within reality. If successful, our mental models see the simulation as reality. Our unconscious senses tell us virtual experience feels like real experience. Of course, we are consciously aware that reality exists, but we can suppress awareness with little effort. Michael Abrash has a definition of successful VR that I really liked. With traditional media, you need active suspension of disbelief to accept that it is real. But with successful VR, you need active suspension of belief to accept that it is not real. So in essence, having to remind yourself that you are just playing a game. And if you want to hear more about this stuff, I recommend to check the YouTube video, Michael Abrash's speech, Why Virtual Reality is Not Just the Next Big Platform. And if you have been paying attention, you notice that today VR does not look like this. We had the first generation of sufficiently good headsets, and input systems are the biggest problem at the moment. Controller abstractions are still necessary, and the sense of touch is essentially completely missing. Today we are stuck between two mediums, like a portal between the real world and the virtual world. We observe the virtual world on the other side, and interact with abstractions on the other. A bit like being born in slow motion, one limb at a time, as new technology is developed. There's a lot of interesting new controllers coming to try to solve this problem. So is it a gimmick? It's just the first piece, and these are baby steps in a new medium. We need to reinvent the wheel on interaction. It's far from complete, but we can already do a lot of interesting things. Just because it is not ready on day one does not mean it's useless. And there's a lot of data dumping in my speech, so a breathing break. And there's still a lot of confusion with what you can do with this new stuff. And there's even a TED talk about how VR is the future of film. And media keeps asking film directors about VR. And they are the wrong people to ask. Apart from being in a VR movie theater, watching a movie on the screen, the art of film is fundamentally incompatible with VR. Film is about precise control of viewer experience and emotional flow, guiding the eye of the viewer, forcing them to understand a specific designed narrative. It's about abstraction of ideas and emotions. The sensation of being there is not the primary goal of film. The frame abstraction is the entire art form. Removing the abstraction would destroy the art. I rest my case. They may be passive film-like experiences with VR, but they will not replace or even compete with traditional film. It's a very different art form. This will be especially interesting with 3D scanned environments. The surrounding world becomes objective, the act of watching much more subjective and unguided. It's about experiencing an objective place or narrative happening around you. Any viewer direction has to be subtly implied, or it comes across as heavy-handed and disruptive. A narrative experience is more like a live theater or a stage play, or like a holodeck recording on Star Trek. You share a space with these actors. There's no longer a social safety glass between you and the events in the room. The fact that you think you can touch them and that they can touch you gives emotional depth to the scene. It's awesome, but it's not film. Another is the novelty experience about space or location, nature documentaries, a live music performance, or a spectacle being in the middle of a massive action sequence. Some films of this type aim for this type of experience, so VR will be properly good for this. It's cool, but has limited potential, and it's also not film. VR is the future of porn. Yes. What porn tries to do is what VR does. You want to be there, experience and empathize as closely as possible, but it will be messy. And then another common saying is that VR is the future of gaming. But traditional games have evolved to the abstractions they were made in. The screen, the controls, the mechanics. The end goal of most games is not the holodeck. Much like film, the abstraction is the art form. Many of the same restrictions apply. Some game mechanics are not possible with VR or give unexpected results. Not everything has to translate to VR. Some types of games translate better than others. And with consoles, there has been an evolution of making games more comfortable, sitting back on a couch in your underwear and playing 8 hours of Arkham City, or only using the muscles on your fingers. I don't want to lose that. I still want games like that. And VR is not that. Retrofitting old games is an exercise in futility. Nearly all of them are terrible ports. A successful port really requires low-level access to the engine. And Half-Life VR mod by Wormslayer is probably one of the more comfortable ones, and it's better than many real VR games. But it raises another problem. It illustrates how level design does not fit well for VR. The levels were designed for desktop play, for the keyboard and mouse, for the monitor frame. It's cool, but it feels like there's something wrong. The abstraction is the art form. VR needs original content, designed for its strengths and weaknesses. One popular fear is that VR is antisocial, or that you look like an idiot wearing it. You should not be doing VR in socially active local environments. That is what traditional media and augmented reality is for. VR as a medium is for situations when you are alone in physical space, when you are isolated in local reality. So why do you care what you look like? For people who are not included in the experience, every type of engaging experience is antisocial, be it traditional games, TV, or books. People also forget the point of VR is to be a reality. Body language and personal space create a real sense of being. these virtual characters feel instinctively human. And people respect each other's personal space, and they gather in a circle to talk. To say that VR is antisocial is to say across the street is antisocial, because your frame of reference is local reality. If I launch this same application in desktop mode, the experience is very different, and the abstraction is back. I'm home, my avatar is in the chat, not me. The body language disappears, other people become distant avatars again, and it feels more like a Skype chat. I'm not going to go over issues with every possible combination of different types of media. Just keep in mind while evaluating something, what makes the original media work? What defines the experience? And does changing the abstractions improve the experience? Same something is VR does not magically make it awesome. Ignoring these issues will lead to bad user experience. And the same applies for hardware, except you pay money for hardware. And because of that, you have stronger emotional reaction to disappointment. VR is at a point where the only thing that can kill VR is bad VR. If people think that a smartphone with a fancy case and some lenses on it is enough for VR, they will be disappointed. And they will likely dismiss VR as a stupid gimmick, as they should. Current phone hardware is not optimized for VR, and there will be high latency. And more power will not solve more important issues, like not having positional tracking, and that will break your sensory feedback loop. When you move and you don't have positional tracking, your movement is not recreated in your virtual body. And now your sensory system has conflicting information. And you sense this movement as movement in the opposite direction. This leads to oscillations as you try to find your virtual balance, like on a boat, and you get simulation sickness. Positional tracking is not optional. You will feel ill. Mobile VR may only be okay for 360 videos or some very short novelty experiences. Be aware of magical claims when supporting products claiming to be VR. Some have misleading advertising and some have outright lies. There is no universal console support. There is no positional tracking without external reference. There's a lot of garbage out there trying to get your money, but there's also a lot of awesome stuff. So now that it's coming, the developers have a big responsibility. If you treat it like a gimmick, that's what it will feel like. Understand the medium, what VR is, and what it tries to do. Not all games have to be VR. Not all VR has to be games. The experience of the experience of presence is fragile. Existing gaming muscle memory is not useful if it conflicts with performed action. If you use controls that do not match your expected mental model, you break the mental model. It brings you out of it. Having a consistently present abstraction is better than a sudden introduction. Make sure you are aware what the mental model looks like in your experience. Does it match what is desired? Is it stable? Does some interaction break it? Traditional abstractions can still work in VR if used with gear. In some cases, you can smuggle other interaction models into VR. Driving with a steering wheel or flying with a joystick works really well because the used control matches what you expect and experience in VR, and the mental model is of controlling a vehicle is familiar to us in reality. And third-person games work because you are controlling a traditional video game in a VR environment. The distinction is subtle but important. It's also a stylistic choice, but keep in mind what kind of mental model it resolves to. Until better interaction arrives, we need to find acceptable compromises. We are settlers on a new continent, and we need to get this right. Please don't make bad VR. A few minutes. I created a few prototypes to study empathy and some VR interaction paradigms. In VR sanity, you are a person with schizophrenia in a store looking for pills. For interaction, I used the Razer Hydra controllers, which offer through 6 degrees of freedom tracking. The immediate sensation from the prototype was that the standing experience is much more immersive. Intuitivity of the 3 degrees of freedom controllers, and the squeezing the triggers to grab stuff is very immersive. But also with the positional tracking, the simulation sickness is really bad. And the forward-facing play doesn't make any sense. Why do I have to face the computer to play a virtual reality game? Virtual blindness was a further study of mechanics. I used TeddyOK's Hydra Deck movement system, where your left Hydra controller is tracking your body movement. And there's no simulation sickness in this, because you have positional tracking. And it feels really immersive. It feels like you could walk off. But using the analog stick to move is really bad. It breaks the whole thing. And it feels worse than in any other experiences because some other areas of the experience are better. The distance between the two mental models has become too large. The better and more natural VR interaction in other areas make all the abstractions feel much worse. Yay. And we made this Fruit Ninja clone game at Millennium Gadget Jam. And you stand on a small platform and use your sword to hit some stuff and dodge with your body. And this is a game without any abstractions. You only have the sword in your hand and use your body to move. Then you can freely move around in the play area. This was really immersive. The mental model was intact. And based on how the abstraction context in third-person games work and how intuitive the Hydra manipulation feels, I wanted to take that man-machine interface we are used to in tank games and such, tank films and such, and smuggle that inside simulation, set it between the player avatar and the simulated world, see if it works as well as it does in reality. So that the mental model contains the tank controls and none of the physical control abstractions. And I required the DK2 for this. And I only got it yesterday, so I didn't have much time to test it. But it works pretty well. Moving and using things in the space feels really natural. But the lack of haptic feedback is an issue if you don't know where your target is. If you can see it, and you know how the object works, it works surprisingly well. VR is awesome. It's not here yet. Be patient. It's coming. There's references. Yep. Thanks.